excited to hear about goopy eyeballs. So conjunctivitis, this is like the thing you guys are going to see most often in any practice you're coming in. It is the lovely yet dreaded pink eye that we all have probably experienced and know people that experience. Conjunctivitis, obviously you guys can tell by the word, it's just an inflammation of the conjunctiva. So again, that's the clear membrane over the surface of the eyes. And to be differentiated from keratitis. Keratitis, when you see that word, means a corneal involvement. So a lot of times you'll see keratitis, sometimes you'll see keratoconjunctivitis, meaning both things are hit, and then there's just conjunctivitis. So be sure when you're charting, you're documenting things appropriately. If the cornea is involved, say it's a keratoconjunctivitis, because that totally is a game changer, because conjunctivitis isn't going to affect your vision. But if the cornea is involved, there's potential for it to affect vision. So eye doctors, if it's there, just like, hey, pay attention. The most common type of conjunctivitis you will see, like, I hate to put a percentage on it, but if I were to say my practice, besides allergic conjunctivitis, which is very, very real, and you see that like every day. If I've seen 20 comprehensive exams, routine eye exams every day, like 19 of them have allergic conjunctivitis. But as far as red eyes, walk-ins, people coming in saying, I have an eye problem, conjunctivitis, 90% of the time it's viral, okay? And viral conjunctivitis is allergic. People are going to come in, their eye's going to be pink, or maybe even red, but most likely pink. They'll have a kind of a foreign body sensation, and usually all that is their eyelids sliding over the swollen, hematic conjunctiva. They might have some itching, they might have some burning, stinging, gritty type of sensations, but the big thing to remember is when their eye's watery. It's like puffy and watery discharge, and it just kind of keeps producing fluid. That clear fluid, or even if they say it's producing mucus, but it's kind of that thin, clear, ropey mucus. It's not goopy, pus-like, nasty stuff. That thin, clear, ropey stuff is basically just dead skin cells, and it's like that sloughing off and getting mixed in with the tears. Almost always, they'll have if it's a moderate to significant one, you'll be able to palpate a lymph node, whether you do a preauricular or submandibular. You'll feel a little node involvement. Palpate, remember, always palpate both sides and feel the difference. Don't necessarily just feel the one anatomy, because everybody's anatomy is a little bit different. And then usually they'll say they've either had, are going through, or are getting over an upper respiratory tract infection, a sinus infection, some type of cold, something like that, an ear infection. You see that all the time. That they've been on around the antibiotics for already, and just kind of everything spilling over into their eyes. Almost always we'll start on one eye and we'll go to the other. It's super, duper, 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 duper contagious and can spread to everybody. Example of this, we had a lady come in with we'll talk about in a minute, which is like the worst type of viral conjunctivitis. From her filling out her intake forms using one of her iPad stylus, we had three other patients that they get it, and my staff of 10, 7 of them get it in a day. In a day. Stuff is like wildfire. So I always tell my patients, I'm like, yeah, this is really contagious. And, you know, like, just to give you an example, as soon as you leave, like, my technicians are going to come in here with Clorox wipes and just wipe everything. Not even, like, they'll wipe the mirror on the wall and everything. Just wipe it all down. Super duper contagious. So you want to be sure that you're gloving up with these people. Or if you don't glove up, just wash the tar out of your hands afterwards, hand sanitize. They need to do the same thing. And the biggest thing you can do for these people is tell them to use their own towel in the kitchen, use their own towel in the bathroom. If they sleep in a bed with somebody, to maybe sleep in a different area or keep their distance. Don't rub one eye and go to the other. The problem with this is usually you're asymptomatic for the first 3-ish days, 4 days, but you're contagious for about the first week. So usually by the time you're seeing symptoms, you've already been contagious for 2 or 3 days. So people aren't getting it. And so you want to tell those people, if it's a kid, they need to stay home from school for at least the first 3 days of symptoms. So if they show up and they've had a red eye for 2 days, they need to stay out of school for a day. If they show up and they woke up that morning with a red eye, they probably need to stay out of school for 2 to 3 days. Because nobody wants them at school, because teachers don't want to deal with their whole class getting this, because it's miserable when it spreads. And the viral is the one that spreads. But it's that pink, watery eye. What makes the eye look red or pink is the dilation, vasodilation of the vessels in the conjunctiva. So if it looks meaty, I mean like a big old steak on their eyes, a big meaty red eye, it's either really, really, really bad viral conjunctivitis or it's probably bacterial, something else. So keep that in mind. That's more your pink eyes, the eyes that look kind of swollen, watery, puffy. That's your viral conjunctivitis. Unless they just say they want to claw their eye out, it's like itching like crazy and they're watering. That's usually, itching is kind of your hallmark sign for allergic conjunctivitis. So differentiate those two. And usually people who have allergies know it, and they've had it before, and it's flaring up on them again. Also, if you have something that's like really sectorial, so like you have a, they're coming in, they're saying their eye's itchy, but it looks kind of viral, but you look at it, it's really only the outside part of their eye, the conjunctiva that's irritated and inflamed and everything, that's probably not viral. Viral's going to get everything, right? It's the allergic conjunctivitis could be something just getting in that one part of the eye that kind of, or something got stuck up under the eyelid, caused things to go haywire on that part and move away. And it won't transfer over to the other eye. But almost always, this jumps over to the other eye because people rub their eyes because it's watering all the time, it's irritated, or they're putting in eye drops and they somehow touch that bottle of their eye and put the eye drop on the other eye. Because people always use a round of Visine and some type of lubricating drop they borrow from somebody. And usually with pink eye, an antibiotic drop they got on Facebook and said, hey, does anybody have the pink eye drops? And got it from somebody else, probably expired, probably contaminated. So always gets transferred. Thing you remember, there, it's a virus. So what do you do for a virus, right? Palliative care, right? You cool compresses, make them feel better. You can prescribe an antibiotic, and they'll tell you, I've been on the antibiotic, the one that was the Polytrim. Or they'll come in and they'll say, I want more of that because it makes it better. Well, if you're smart, you won't put them on antibiotic. You put them on an antibiotic and a steroid, which is called Tobradex, right? You'll put them on that because they're going to get some relief from the dexamethasone, right, the steroid. But all the steroid's doing is it's going to make their eye look less red. It's going to make them feel a little more comfortable because steroids make the eyes feel better in these types of things. But remember, what's fixing the problem is their immune system. So it's fine to put them on those drops, but you want to be sure they know that they're still contagious. They still can spread it for a couple days. So they need to use good hand washing. Use their own towels. Don't use the kitchen towel. Stay away from kids. All those types of things. So keep that in mind. So does that make sense? Viral versus allergic conjunctivitis? There's a thing called pharyngeoconjunctival fever, which is PCF, and basically it's your classic triad. You're gonna see, it's almost always kids you're gonna see. You rarely ever see adult PCF. They're gonna have pharyngitis, fever, and conjunctivitis. It's kind of like, it's a virus that just got everything on one side. Really, treatment's the same. A lot of times you'll put them on an oral antibiotic as well, just to treat the other things, just to be safe and make sure you're covering off. The EKC is epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. This actually has its own diagnosis code, and it's in a separate diagnosis code than the eye codes. It's, and this is the one that's like the worst of the worst of the worst of conjunctivitis. This is the person that you, hopefully you don't ever have to deal with one of these, because these can go through your office like wildfire, and they're bad, bad, bad boys. So this is your pink eye, classic one. Comes in, little injected, not any subconjunctival hemorrhages or anything like that, just a little bit of redness, a little bit of watering, chemosis, pink eye. You're going to treat them. Make sure they know it's a virus. If they want the antibiotic, say, I'll put you in a drop that has an antibiotic and a steroid, and it will cover all our bases. But remember, you're still going to be contagious. Palpate those nodes, see if they're there. Remember, the conjunctiva isn't just what's on the white part of the eye. The conjunctiva extends around and is on the inside of the eyelids as well. So the bottom inside of that, the inside of the top eyelid is the conjunctiva. It's all the same tissue. We just kind of call it the bulbar conjunctiva, which is on the eye, and then the palpebral conjunctiva, which is, it spills over and is on the inside of the eyelids. So you could look underneath there and chart, you know, oh yeah, there's swollen and hematic underneath there too as well. EKC is a booger. So when EKC comes in, these people, usually their eyelids are swollen completely shut, or their conjunctiva is so chemotic that it's hanging out onto their bottom eyelid. And I mean that in all extents of the word. And these people are not happy. But when EKC hits, it's bad news bears because it's super, super, super duper contagious, and it's just bad. I have an EKC right now I've been treating for a year and a half. And it's still, it is better. The EKC is gone, but some of the long-term sequelae is still there. So these people, there's not a lot to do for it. We always put them on a Tobradex or something like that to make them feel better. But the big problem with it is you get these subepithelial infiltrates, or SEIs is what we call them. And so there's these little white specks on the front part of the eye. I know it's hard to see in that picture, but those can be recurrent. And those basically cause all kinds of halos at night, distortions to their vision. And the only way to make those go away, because remember those are just collections of white blood cells in the cornea, is just keep them on steroids. Keep them on steroid eye drop for a long time, which you guys never have to do. So you guys are always going to hand that off. But if you get like somebody comes in with that little bit of pink eye, mom's going to drop for the kids, it's fine. But if you get a one that comes in and you walk in the room, you go, oh my gosh, ooh, you have pink eye. You want to, here's your Tobradex and go see an eye doctor. the next day, because we're actually going to see those people, and we'll start them on a stronger steroid. We'll monitor them pretty closely for at least 6 months. So going on out, and some people don't form the infiltrates, but most people do. And so you can see from this timeline that's up here, you have this incubation period of 8 days. Traditionally, we're taught it's more of a 3-day incubation period where it's there, but you don't have any symptoms. And that period of infectivity is up to 14 days afterwards with EKC. And the only way you can eliminate this is a lot of times, and this is where if somebody shows up and they say, I woke up this morning with an eye like this and I was fine yesterday, if you can call my office or somebody's office that can get in the same day, we can actually put the fire out entirely. And what we do is we do a betadine lavage. You just have to be sure you use ophthalmic betadine. And you numb them up really, really good with topical anesthetic, and you put about 3 drops of topical betadine in their eye, and you have them roll it around for about 15 seconds, and then you irrigate it out for about 10 minutes. They hate you, because that anesthetic will wear off in about 30 minutes, and they will be miserable for the rest of the day. I mean, like, miserable. But they'll wake up the next morning, their eye will be white, quiet, and beautiful. And when you do that, you rarely ever have the infiltrates that occur. But what you've done is you've dropped a nuclear bomb on the surface of the eye. And the reason they're uncomfortable is because all their epithelium is gone. So it's like having a giant scratch on the front part of their eye for a whole day. But the problem is we have to do that within the first really 24 hours. We prefer to do it within the first 12 hours. So if they come in and they're like, my eye's been like this for 2 or 3 days, no point even trying that. But if they woke up this morning and they're in your chair at 9 o'clock, say, you know what, let's get you over to see an eye doctor. Because there might be something they can do, it's worth a shot. That's kind of a like off-label thing that not a lot of people do, but I mean, I guarantee you, if you ever get EKC, the day it pops up and it's really bad, go to an eye doctor and tell them, I want betadine in my eye, because you'll be very glad you did, because you won't be dealing with it a year and a half later. So, tricky little guy. These are the EKC people, they're not happy. Just yucky, yucky, yucky. He might have some ectropion too, right? There's no point in using Visine, getting the red out. The way Visine works is it uses a dilating drop that we use called Nafcon A. It dilates the pupil, but it causes vasoconstriction, so it gets the red out. But it's basically phenylephrine, and it causes rebound inflammation. So if you ever anybody chronically using Visine, it's like the perfect drop. It's got them in the cycle, and they're hooked, and you want to break the cycle, because it actually starts to cause more problems, because it breeds low-grade chronic inflammation. So we always tell patients, don't use Visine. The only time I tell people to use Visine is if, like, they're going to a wedding and they have viral conjunctivitis and they won't get pictures and they don't want to have a pink eye. I'll say, hit it with a drop of Visine and you'll be good for 2 hours. And then it'll come back with a vengeance and hit it with another one and then stop. But we'll get you fixed up later. So just avoid that and put them on Tobradex and get them to an eye doctor or something like that. There is a new treatment that's a topical ganciclovir that is kind of, they're trying to get an indication to use it for viral conjunctivitis. It's like god-awful expensive, and it's incredibly hard to get. It's actually on back order until April right now. It's what we use to treat herpes when it gets into the eye. So I know that because I have 2 cases I'm dealing with right now managing samples. So that you'll never have to use that. You'll kick it out before then. Acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, you don't see this very often. It's usually really, really sick people, usually people that are undergoing chemo, some type of immunocompromised state. You see it with AIDS patients sometimes and things like that, but more often people that are undergoing chemo or treatments and things like that. Comes on, hits them fast. Things don't look too injected. It's just these subconjunctival hemorrhages. They're all the way around. They usually kind of congregate around the limbus, but they can be anywhere and everywhere. And there's not a whole lot to do for it because it's viral. So it's just kind of deal with it and tell them it's going to be ugly and it's probably going to get worse for the first week before it gets better. Because the virus has to get taken care of, and then the body has to absorb all the blood. So again, you can put them, if they are injected or they're uncomfortable, or they're swollen, and you can put them on a steroid, and it'll help some. It's never a fun one, but because it looks bad. And then allergic conjunctivitis, seasonal, perennial. You guys know that happens with what you're around and just being in Oklahoma. I have some of my patients, allergies are just a side effect of being in Oklahoma. Really, really good medications over the counter. All of the medications are basically the same, even the prescription ones that we use for maintenance. They're antihistamine mast cell stabilizer combos. The prescription ones you use one time a day, Pataday, Zayo, those types of things. You can also put them on if it's really severe. You can put them on a steroid, like a low steroid, like Alrex, things like that. We always try to watch their pressures with steroids because steroids can cut. There's about 30% of the population that have pressure inside their eye spike when they're on a steroid. So that's why I tell you guys to tread really tightly with steroids. Because if there's any type of like herpetic involvement, it can be like formic acid on fire. So tread lightly, make sure there's not corneal involvement before you do it. And if there's not corneal involvement, you're pretty much safe. But the Zatador and Alloway, they're the two most common over-the-counter. But nowadays, you can go back to the eye drop section, I call it the wall of tears, at Walmart or CVS or whatever, and there'll be like 18,000 eye drops that are for allergies, allergic conjunctivitis. Tell them to get the one that is says comparable to Zatador or Alloway. Because always get a generic, because it's cheaper. But they're all the same thing. There's the Claritin branded ones, they're the exact same things. The over-the-counter ones, 2 to 3 times a day. The prescription ones only have to be used 1 time a day. So people are going to be on them all the time like those. Vernal keratoconjunctivitis and atopic keratoconjunctivitis are just going to look like conjunctivitis, but even worse. And when you pull down their eyelids, it's going to look like they have tons of blisters up underneath their eyelids. But remember, the telltale sign of any of this stuff is itching. They want to claw their eyes out. So ask them on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad do your eyes itch? And they'll say, well, they're kind of burning and pretty. No, how bad do they itch? And if they say greater than a 4 or 5, it's probably allergic if it's itching. This just because we all know the cascade of allergies and how that works. You can get a ropey discharge, and you can get a lot of chemosis like this. This is normally when I see that swollen cons, like you see in that top picture where it's hanging out, you automatically think like EKC. But sometimes when it's severe allergies, these are people that know it. These are people that have been on allergy shots for years, are still miserable, and when they get around a cat, they have asthma attacks to the point where they can't breathe. You know, those are those people, and they'll get around a cat and they'll come in with their eye looking like that. All you can do is throw steroids on it hard and heavy. I mean, this is one that you'd send to me and I'd put them on Pred Forte every hour for a day and see them back every day until it got better. So, I mean, these are people that you probably don't want to manage them with that. But you also, in a primary care physician setting, give them a shot, a steroid, and it's going to make that a million times better. Or you can put them on a dose pack and it's going to help out a ton. So, put them on a medical dose pack. And so a lot of times these people come in, I'll put them on topical steroids every hour and oral Benadryl dose pack, and they'll do better. So you'll see these bumps underneath the eyelids, and really don't need to worry about them too much, because if you ever pull down an eyelid and you see these big, matty, mounded bumps like that, those are papillae or follicles, and they basically look like blisters underneath the eyelid, but that means something's going on, and you need to get them out to an eye doctor. Because it could be underlying systemic disease, but most often it's not. It's related to either contact lens wear or something that's going on with their eyes that needs some long-term intense steroid therapy. And like I said, you guys just don't want to have to manage that, because you guys probably don't even want to check their eye pressure when they're there. And they need to be followed up for secondary glaucomas and things like that. Cool compresses, I have people that swear by them. And if you ever have really bad allergies, try it yourself. You just have to keep cold on there, an ice pack for a good 10 minutes, and it'll make you feel better for hours. It really, really does, because it's vasoconstriction, right? The opposite of a warm compress. Constrict down those blood vessels, and there's much opportunity for that stuff to spill out on your eye. Topical antihistamines, mast cell stabilizers, all that stuff. Reach for your steroids when you need them. Just make sure the cornea is not involved. I'm not even going to worry about vernal, because it's nasty. When you see it, it's nasty. Again, you'll see, the thing about vernal is you'll see stuff going on with cornea, so you'll see stuff on it. When there's stuff on the cornea, it's at risk, so get it out. You don't want that on your malpractice. You want somebody else that has malpractice to handle that one. Atopic keratoconjunctivitis, these are people that know it. They have atopic disease. They have skin issues, and people you've been treating for psoriasis, eczema type of things, and then they start to get issues with their eyes. You kind of do the same thing. Those are people that need steroids. They don't need the palliative care. They need steroids, topical steroids. So the big hairy thing is people think when they get pink eye, they think they have a bacterial infection. And how do we treat bacterial infections? With antibiotics, right? So people are going to come in and they're going to want antibiotics from you. And there's a big public health debate, and there's lots of problems with antibiotic use when it's not pertinent. But when people come and see you for an eye infection, whether it's pink eye or whether it's bacterial conjunctivitis, they want an eye drop, right? Well, like I said, if it's viral, what I do is I put them on one that has both in it. If they really want to drop, then I explain to them and help them understand. And most people know by now, if they have a virus, they have to let it run its course, and I can make you look better and feel better, but it's not going to get better for a while. But bacterial infection is usually pretty easy to delineate, because their eye's meaty red, it looks like a steak, and they usually have some goop coming out of their eye. And it can be like hyperacute, where it's just you wipe away all the goop, and you turn around and make a note in your chart, and you turn around to the patient, and there's goop where it comes back in. That's like, that's nasty. But it can't just be they wake up and their eyes are matted shut, and then they're wiping every hour or two and pulling out this green, yellowish, goopy stuff. Remember, it's not white and watery and thin. It's green, it's thick, it's mucopurulent. That stuff is bad almost always when they wake up in the morning, their eyelids are matted shut. Eyelashes are, even once they get it all off, their eyelashes still are kind of matted together in big strands. Those are people you can almost always assume when there's mucopurulent discharge bacterial eyes. For you guys, in the settings you guys are in, the safest thing to do, like polytrim, polysporin trimethoprim. Ointment, if it's a kid, drops if it's an adult. QID, it's a great broad spectrum coverage. If there are contact lens wear, and you be sure you look at that cornea and make sure there's no white spots on it and there's no cornea involvement, because if there is, they need to go see an optometrist or an ophthalmologist. But if the cornea is not involved, it's just goopy and they're contact lens wearer. The big fear with contact lens wearers is Pseudomonas. Pseudomonas is a flesh-eating bacteria and can literally eat away the cornea in a period of 36 hours. So we care about that a lot because it can make things go south in a hurry. And so contact lens wearers are like 20 times more likely to have Pseudomonas infection than non-contact lens wearers. So if you get a really bad bacterial conjunctivitis and they're a contact lens wearer, tell them to stop wearing their contacts if they haven't already done that. Get them started on some drops and say you need to see an eye doctor by tomorrow, just to make sure. We don't ever culture anymore unless we're just not making progress with treatment, just because it's more hassle than it's worth, honestly. But a lot of times these people that are contact lens wearers, if it's Pseudomonas and we can't get it under control of what we're treating them with, we go to 4-5 antibiotics. That has to be compounded. Pseudomembranes. So that's one thing to remember too. If it looks like there's a bunch of discharge down there, but you get like a cotton tip applicator and you pull their lid down and you kind of grab it and roll it out, and it looks like it was more like a big strand of like tissue, it actually can be a membrane in there. And sometimes it looks like it's discharge, it's not. And usually when you see a membrane or a pseudomembrane, it's from inflammation, it's not from infection. So you're thinking about people that have really bad uncontrolled inflammation, autoimmune disorders and things like that. Those people, obviously, they need to be on a steroid and not an antibiotic, right? But it's not going to hurt you, put them on both. So just put them on both if there's something going on there. And again, these people have a nodule, too. You'll go and you'll palpate and you'll get a preauricular submandibular node when you palpate that with those. Again, the name of the game for you guys is if you see a white spot on a cornea, they need to go see an eye doctor because vision's at risk. So these things, where it spills over from being conjunctivitis to a keratoconjunctivitis, it doesn't matter how small or where it's located, they need to see an eye doctor. And primarily because if there's infiltrates of the limbus is super, super, super reactive because that's where all the blood vessels are, it's where all that reproduction of the tissue occurs. But at the central, we're talking about vision. So when you look at those eyes, even if you're looking outside of a microscope, get real close to them and get that translucent. If you see a white spot on their cornea without any stain in their eye or anything like that, get them over to see an eye doctor. White spot can compromise vision because infiltrates can always leave a scar behind if they're there for a long time. Any questions? Okay. Hypercute bacterial conjunctivitis, these are the ones where it's just pouring out of their eyes, almost always kids we see, and it's usually, this is why like whenever babies are born now they get erythromycin dosed in their eyes, they get erythromycin ointment first thing, pull them out of mommy and either do whatever they do, skin time or whatever, but as soon as they get their initial medical workup, they get erythromycin ointment stripped in their eye, usually whether you want it or not, because that just kills off any gonorrhea that might have been there, and that's the most common hyperacute bacterial conjunctivitis. It's little newborn Mondeo babies and eyes are just pouring goo if it's not treated. So that's the same way you treat it too, is if you see a hyperacute bacterial conjunctivitis, so somebody that's just pouring out mucus, they're wiping it away, and you're wiping it away, the best thing to reach for is like erythromycin at that point. Those macrolide antibiotics actually do the best job with those the bugs that cause those things. Copious discharge, the yuckiest cases ever. They can have lidedema as well, but usually it's just conjunctival, just irritated. That's literally not a bad example of what it looks like. It is gross. It is gross, 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 gross. Makes you squirm in your chair. Glove up when you're dealing with those people, just for your sake. Again, we don't culture or anything like that. you usually throw those people on a broad spectrum where they've done like a fluoroquinolone, and we have like a fourth, fifth generation fluoroquinolones we use now. But I'm telling you, Polytrin does a better job than half of those most of the time in those situations. And it's cheap and it works well. So chronic bacterial conjunctivitis. This is the person you treat, you get them better, and they're back in your chair 3 days later, and their corn out goop again. The first thing you want to be sure you pay attention to those people is their lids. Make sure they're not dumping stuff off their lashes and lids into their eye. So are their lids clean? Has the infection gone? Their lids are clean now. Make sure they're not asking. In the morning, you wake up and you have a lot of matter, you have a lot of debris, because if their lids are dirty, they're going to get chronic recurrent conjunctivitis. If they're a dirty person because they're a farmer or they work outside in the summer and they sweat all day and things like that, then they're dirty people. And you probably want to put them on some type of maintenance kind of lid therapy, whether it's baby shampoo or whatever it might be. And these, you know, men have a hard time following that sometimes, but once they've had a few infections, they'll realize a bottle of baby shampoo every other month is a lot cheaper than a copay every 2 weeks and a bottle of antibiotic drops. So they'll start doing it. So any questions about conjunctivitis? Steroids for inflammation, antibiotics for that. So what's your antibiotic of choice? Polytrin. And then antibiotic steroid, if you use steroid?
Tobradex.
Tobradex, safe ones. We say this because it's like commonly, almost always when people come in from an urgent care or from an ER or something, they're always on like a sulfa drop or something like that. And like you'll never see an eye doctor write those because like 90% of the population is sensitive to them. And the preservatives they use in the generic ones of those are like terrible for the eye. So they usually make things worse. And so a lot of times they'll be on an antibiotic for bacterial conjunctivitis and they'll come in and we'll put them on a different antibiotic and they'll get better. Not because we chose the right one, we just chose the newer one. Because you'll look in your book, whatever you know clinical reference you might use, and that'll be what it tells you to use. But if you remember those two, you'll be pretty safe covering your background. Okay, you can get chlamydia in the eye, and the way you note that is if you're dealing with somebody and there's concerns for chlamydia, whether they be an old lady in a nursing home or a you know sexually active young person, you'll get a hyperacute conjunctivitis, so really bad bacterial conjunctivitis. You'll treat it, you'll get it under control, and then it'll come back. And if it comes back, and these people usually are treated for conjunctivitis for about 6 to 8 weeks before you finally go, maybe there's something else going on here. And you'll either run tests, or what we do is we just put them on a gram dose of azithromycin and see if it gets better, and almost always it does. And then you have to go through the talk with them and tell them. Hopefully they're not like 14 and you have to tell mom and all that stuff, but you have to have the talk with them saying you need to talk to all your partners, all the people in your life, because this could be a public health issue. It is a reportable disease, so you should report it, but nowadays it's not necessarily common enough that that happens. So so just know that if you have a chronic recurrent conjunctivitis in somebody who is sexually active, that isn't monogamous or something like that, then always come for that and treat that a little bit. Because if it takes the care of the systemic infection, it will keep coming back and back and back and back and back. It doesn't look any different than kind of a bacterial conjunctivitis type of thing. So that is conjunctivitis. Any questions about any of that? Okay. The cornea is a lot more complex than conjunctivitis, but it's one of those things that, like I've told you, your job when you see something involving a cornea, unless it's just a dry eye, and you put that stain we talked about in, and you just see a bunch of surface staining and a little bit of irritation, tell them to use lubricants. But if you're having somebody who has corneal disease, whether it's a foreign body that got stuck in their eye, or whether it's something else like that, vision is at risk. So if I were you, I would not want them on my plate in whatever setting you're in. So your job is to make them comfortable, get the process started, and tell them to get to see an eye doctor or follow up with an eye doctor at some point, whether they have one of their own or not. There's a whole lot of different things that can happen with the cornea. Probably the most common things you guys will deal with will either be foreign bodies, trauma, scratches to the eye, or what we call erosions. So people wake up first thing in the morning, open their eye, and the surface tissue rips off the cornea. These people come in and they're screaming. They're miserable, terribly uncomfortable. Your job is to patch them up and send them over because those can become very recurrent things. And also remember, people that are just really, really immunocompromised, their corneas can head south on you fast. And a lot of times people get put on chemo and their oncologist will give them a bottle of steroids and say, hey, use this twice a day to keep your eyes calm, which is perfectly safe, but they're already immunocompromised and then we're immunocompromising their service there even further. So if something goes wrong, we gotta really get on top of those people quickly. So the main thing to remember is if the cornea gets insulted, it's so painful and irritating that that inflammation almost always spills over inside the eye. And so we will have what's called like an iritis, and the main thing to look for there is photophobia. So if somebody's outside and they're really, really light sensitive, and I don't mean they go outside and go, oh, everything's bright, I need my sunglasses. They go outside and they wince up in pain. The best way I can describe that to you, it's like a Charlie horse happening inside their eye. All their muscles are spasming, locking down, and that's a very big problem. And that tells you that something serious is happening. They're in a lot of pain. And the way we fix that is we paralyze those muscles with drops, and we treat the underlying problem. But you're looking for redness, blurred vision, especially if it gets close to central vision, things are going to seem blurry, but you guys will know that from their VAs. Their VAs will be reduced. You know, always want to pay attention to corrected VAs, so if they're a person that wears glasses, check their vision with their glasses on and see where it's at. And if it's like 20/30 or worse, then you can kind of assume it's reduced. Looking for watery or mucopurulent discharge and photophobia. If they wear contact lenses, the number one thing I can tell you is tell them to get them out, and when they take them out, like, as long as they're not by themselves and they can drive home, take them and throw them away while they're in the room. Be like, throw those away. Because you don't want them going back home and putting them back on, because it's only going to make things worse. Most eye doctors will get them a pair to get them by, unless they just tell you, my script's huge, don't throw away their contact. But because they have to get home safely. So these are some of the things you'll see. You'll see these ulcerations or these epithelial defects on the surface, especially if you see blood vessels moving in towards it and growing. Badger's bears, you want to put in that dye. If you put in that dye, that sodium fluorescein, and that white spot turns green under the blue light, that means there's no surface tissue over it, and that means it's an ulcer with a big plaque of immune cells underneath. That's big time bad, especially if you look at it and it looks like you can almost see a divot there. You can appreciate the divot. That means something really bad's happening because they're into the stroma deeply there at that point. So if you put the dye in and the white spot just stays white and the tears are just sitting on the surface of it, then you know it's just immune cell stuff underneath there. And that one's like, they can wait until tomorrow to go see the eye doctor. But if it's an ulcer, they need to go see the eye doctor today, type thing. Especially if they're contact lens wearer, because if they're contact lens wearer, all bets are off. They're exposed to a lot of other stuff. Or you can use your common sense. Like if they've been at the lake all weekend and they're in your chair on Monday, or they were like, yeah, I was in the hot tub last night with all my friends, and we got out. Those types of environments where there's potential for a lot of stuff to be around that is stuff you don't want in your eyes, those types of things, it's like, okay, yeah, here's some antibiotics to go to the eye doctor because those eyeballs can be gone quickly. Or if they tell you they're outside gardening, bunch of dirt knocked up in their eye or something like that, then you're worried about a fungal keratitis and things like that. So we kind of talked about these infiltrates or these white plaques in the eye as sterile versus infective. The best way to remember that is if it's an infection, it'll have an overlying defect almost always, so they'll be staining on the surface, and the patient will be really uncomfortable. There's a lot more discomfort, whereas a sterile infiltrate, patients usually, they might have mild irritation, mild form body sensation, but they're terrible. People that have an ulcer are not happy. They are struggling. They can't keep their eye open. They're super sensitive to light when they go outside. Things like that. There are people that you walk in the room and like you open the door and everything's pitch black. And you're like, oh, that's not good. Because I turned out all the lights. Or your nurse turned out all the lights before they left because they were so uncomfortable. So anytime you see the white spot, get them out. There's kind of bacterial keratitis, which we treat with antibiotics. The closer it is to the visual axis, the more concerning it is because the more impact it can have on vision, the higher scar risk. So that picture on the upper right there, that's a classic bacterial ulcer right there. And you can, I always tell people, pretend like it's a target and use the pupil in normal illumination as your target. So if it's anywhere near the pupil, if any of it's touching the edge of the pupil or closer, that's bad. All bets are off. We've got to get those people taken care of. Like that one on the bottom right, that one is going to head south on some hurry. And you can actually, if you look really closely, you'll see the defect is actually a lot bigger than the white spot. So you see the white spot, and then the defect spills over almost all the way to the edge of the eye. So these are ones we got to get fixed, and we got to get fixed quick. And we can do a lot of things to make them comfortable in the meantime, too, in our offices with different drops and stuff like that. So that's why it's important to get them out of your door. We don't culture anymore. The main thing that we run into that we wish we would have cultured is whenever we realize it's not bacterial, It's actually a fungal infection, or what we call an Candida infection, which are two big bad ones. And we really don't need to go into this too much, because when you guys see these things, you're going to get them out of your door. But I do want you to see a fungal keratitis, because it's a little bit different. So bacterial keratitis, you have this big, dense, white plaque. You have usually an overlying defect. Usually the patient's really uncomfortable. A lot of times there are contact lens wear. When you see a fungal keratitis, so sometimes it won't look as bad. Like that one on the bottom left, you see how there's a white spot there, but it's not nearly as distinct. You see how it's kind of more just feathery and spread out, and you can kind of see through it. When you see those feathery edges, or if you see two or three big spots, and they're kind of connected together by some feathery edges, almost always a fungal keratitis. And fungal keratitis are bad. Almost, probably, if you put maybe put a percentage on it, probably 70 to 80% of these people go on to need cornea transplant. Or we take the cornea off and put another one on at some point, our corneal surgeon does. And we treat these guys with everything we have, but unfortunately there's not any good antifungals to topically get the eye. So what we do is we compound that. We have pharmacists compound that what we have and dump it on there, but even like systemic fungal infections, a lot of times it just don't get better, especially if they're a sick person. If they're a well person, sometimes they can do that, but if they're diabetic, or a person that is just not in a well state because they have a lot of other systemic disease, or they're immunocompromised, all bets are off. And usually the eyes look pretty angry. Like you see, like if you pay attention not just to the cornea in those pictures, but you pay attention to the conjunctiva, I mean, that's enough to make you guys go, ah, that's bad. You know, that eye's mean. It doesn't look good. But remember, fluffy or feathery defects that are real translucent and soft, those are fungal keratitis. And those ones, I guess a way to sum that up is, if you see that type of look, send them straight to the ophthalmologist, or to Dean McGee, or to somebody like that. If you just see a normal ulcer and their contact lens wear and they're real sensitive, and it's that dense white plaque, send them to see me. Send them to see all these people. But if you send me to see one of those to see me, I'm going to say, you need to go see those guys. That's the only difference we're going to do. Okay? So you're just saving them a visit by knowing that. There's always an epithelial defect with the fungal keratitis, and it's almost always from vegetative matter, too. So you know that person that got hit in the eye with a tree branch, or fingernail to the eye from their kid, wrestling around with their kid on the ground, or whatever. That's what they look like in the end stage. So either the cornea perks, or they're just gone. And you can't see through that. Not good. Yep. And sometimes they form what's called a ring ulcer. So that one on the bottom right, you see this kind of circular pattern with the translucency in the middle. Those defects will come together and form a little circle. But obviously, if you guys are trying to treat something that looks like that, you'll have braver than I am, because I don't treat that. And then the other one to remember, there is there's an infection called acanthamoeba. This one is a little bit hairy, because what will happen is they'll come in and you'll think they'll have conjunctivitis, because they'll be saying, and people who come with conjunctivitis, they're mad because their eyes look good, and they go, yeah, it doesn't feel good. Maybe they're a little sensitive to light. But people that come in with acanthamoeba, you look at their cornea and you won't see anything at all, or hardly anything at all. Their conjunctiva really will look pretty quiet. It won't even look swollen or anything like that. But what they're telling you is they're going, this hurts. Like, on a scale of 1 to 10, this is a 10, probably an 11 in this worst-case scenario. So kind of the catch-all clinical term is pain that doesn't align with symptoms, or pain that doesn't align with signs, what you're actually seeing. So somebody's coming in saying, I'm miserable, my eye feels like it's going to explode, something feels like it's eating my eye alive, but you don't see much going on at all. That. And those people need to go straight to the ophthalmologist, straight to Dean McGee if you practice in Oklahoma City, wherever your cornea specialists are, because the only way to detect that is through what we call confocal microscopy. It's a special microscope that's only at academic institutions and things like that, and the treatment for that stuff is crazy. It's a tricky deal. The other way they catch it is, because basically what this is it's an amoeba. It's floating around on your eye, chewing on your cornea, and so you can't really see it until it gets too much damage there to leave stuff behind. And so the other way they do it is we'll culture it and we'll put it on a plate with E. coli, and we'll watch the little booger eat up all the E. coli on the arm, like down in the lab. That's how they used to do it. But now we have a microscope. As long as you can get them a microscope, you can catch it pretty quick. I've had two of these in my day, and we both thought they were fungal ulcers that turned into this, and both needed PKPs. But it doesn't happen that often. If somebody comes in and is miserable and you see a quiet eye, go away. Go see somebody else. acanthamoeba is a not fun one. Actually, one of my employees that had that when she was a teenager did just fine. So, got caught early. So again, usually going to be around our environment like a lake or a hot tub. Those are called the hot tub ulcer. Those environments where it's warm, moist, and yucky. Corneal abrasions, you'll see these all the time. Somebody getting scratched with the fingernail, somebody getting whacked with an eye, somebody getting something in their eye, and you just see a bunch of tiny little streaks on the surface of the eye, and you look in there and you flip the lids and you can't see anything, you've irrigated out their eye. It's a scratches. And like I told you guys in the beginning, scratches, superficial stuff, heals up super fast on the eye, like 12 hours, 24 hours, and that's better. But if it's big, or there's a big scratch and it's in the center part of their eye, you're worried about vision. They probably need to follow up with an eye doctor. But the main thing is lubrication, so keep the eye moist and comfortable, and then if there's any history of vegetative matter, then cover yourself for infection. So put them on Polytrim or something like that to cover for infection. If they're really, really, really photophobic, sensitive to light, then you probably want to send them to see an eye doctor. Because what we usually do in this case to make them feel more comfortable is we put them in a bandaged contact lens. So we'll actually put a soft contact lens on that fits really tight, and we'll have them just leave it on for 2 or 3 days while the tissue heals over, and then we'll pull that off. But when you pull that off, you have to pull it off a little delicately because you don't want to pull that new tissue off with it that's grown on there. So you kind of lubricate things up. And obviously you guys aren't, no matter where you're at, they won't have bandaged contact lenses because we pull those out of our fitting sets. So, but that's how we make those people feel more comfortable. And you can always think about, if the abrasion is really bad, you can always put them on some type of pain management. So think about things like oral pain management and everything like that. The top left picture, that's like foreign body tracking. Always make sure there's nothing in their eye whenever you see that, whenever you see those streak marks. That's what the dye looks like. So that's kind of an example of when there's a scratch, the dye soaks into the stroma right there. You see those types of scratches. And so I can almost guarantee you on this one, there's something stuck under that guy's eyelid, and every time he blinks, it's just scratching right there in that area. If you go fish it out and you can't find it, you irrigate it out of that eye the best you can, then it's probably not there. You're just seeing what's left behind. And remember, when you irrigate out an eye, you don't just take a saline bottle and drip it in there. You pry that eye open, get a ton of paper towels, and you just hold that thing down. Like if I were squeezing the bottle, it'd hit the back wall. That's how hard I squeeze a bottle of saline. Or you can use a Morgan lens. Did you guys ever see a Morgan lens? Have you shown? If you ever work in an ER, you'll see Morgan lenses. It's like a little contact lens that has a hose coming out of it, hooks up to an IV bag of saline. You basically, you numb their eye with the top of anesthetic, you stick the contact on underneath their eyelids, and then you start the IV drip, and it just irrigates for you. And if they ever have a chemical burn, you leave them on that, you do 2 or 3 bags of fluid, it'll be hours. And then you basically ball up gauze over here and let it catch all the moisture for you, and just keep replacing it. But that's an easy way, so you don't have to stand there for 20 minutes with 5 bottles of saline and spray them in their eye. Just set it up and have a nurse attend to it, and go about your way. But yeah, anytime you see white, you're getting out of the office. Do not, if you see loose tissue hanging off the surface of an eye, of a cornea, do not go trying to debride it or pulling it off of there or anything like that. If there's something stuck in there, you can go after it as long as it's not in the center of the eye. But I would just say for you guys, tread incredibly lightly, because how you get that out of the eye and how much collateral damage you cause is going to affect their visual outcome. That's probably the number one factor. So especially if it's metal, so if you look in there and you see metal, it'll look brown and rusted because it rusts in about 2 to 4 hours of contact. Get it out of there, because we not only have to get the big piece of metal out, we have to get all the other rust that's soaked into the tissue out. And so we use an instrument called an Alder brush and basically drill it out gently and with as least collateral damage as possible. But the Alder brush is important because it won't put enough pressure to go through the cornea, because that would be bad. Right? Anytime you have a high-speed projectile, so somebody who's welding, grinding after welding, somebody who's weed eating, using a sander in a shop, or woodworking, or cutting, using a saw, things like that, always have to rule out penetrating wound. So the way you do that is you look for what we call a Seidel sign. So you're going to put that stain in their eye, and you're going to basically make sure there's not stuff coming out of the eye slowly. And you'll see that as basically new fluid leaking out in the middle of the room you're seeing. So make sure there's no penetrating. If there's penetrating injury, they need to go to the ER immediately because they need on-call ophthalmology, get in there and fix it. So you just want to make sure there's no penetrating injury, because a lot of times if it goes through right, they won't have any visual changes per se other than things seem a little fuzzy. So that's like a picture of what a metallic foreign body would look like in the cornea. So it kind of looks like that rusted thing. And that one, actually, you can probably take the cotton tip out and pop that puppy out. But if you pop it out, half the cornea comes with it. It's bad. So we use a little instrument called the golf club spud to kind of get around the edges and lift it up and try and gently pull it out of the eye. And then just kind of use the algae brush to breed off any soft edges where that iron soaked into. And a lot of times these don't come out as a solid piece. If they've been in there for more than about 12 hours, you can hit it and it just starts to flake apart into little bitty pieces. So you just have to be real careful with metallic foreign bodies especially. But if you can see something on there, you see a big white spot, like a big, kind of like a clear spot, or they say they were in the beach and they got sand in their eye, things like that. Look for that. If their person's been installing insulation and you can't see anything at all, but they feel like there's beads in their eye, they probably have fibroblasts in their eye, don't try and dig it out. Just irrigate and numb them and get them to the eye doctor's office. Prophylactic antibiotics, all that stuff. Any questions? Okay, now we're moving from the surface of the eye, we're moving inside the eye. This is the one part that, remember how we have the anterior chamber and the posterior chamber? Everything in front of the iris is the anterior chamber. One thing you guys will encounter, it'll probably come along, blowout fractures and things like that, is called hyphema. And hyphema is basically blood in the anterior chamber, blood in the front part of the eye. And so when you see a hyphema, it's always from some type of high-speed object hitting the eyeball, and it's a bleed, and it could slowly leak blood into the front part of the eye. We kind of quantify these patients as depending on how much blood there is, so if it's just a little bit versus halfway up the eye versus all the way full. You guys' job when you see that is you need to make a referral for them to see an eye doctor, but in the meantime, they need to minimize their physical activity. They need to sleep upright, so they don't want to be laying down flat. Because you want to let gravity work in your favor, right? You want to have it pushed down. So they need to be upright, sleeping in a recliner or a chair or something like that. They don't have to come see us that same day, or even the next day if they're in the hospital or anything like that. They just need to come see an eye doctor for management, because what we're worried about at that point is glaucoma, as well as some other things that can spill over from that blood in the front part of the eye, and the blood doesn't go away fast. It goes away very slowly over a long time. So your job is to minimize their mobility. If they are taking any type of blood thinning medication like Coumadin and warfarin, you can probably go to work with their primary care physician or whoever had them on that to make sure that you can stop that for a little bit. It would be preferable if it's not stoppable because of other risks, because you don't want them to stroke out and things like that. Then you want to work with different things like sometimes we'll come in and we'll put a lens on their eye and apply pressure and try and stop bleeding if it's still actively happening. But most of the time it's stopped by the time they're in your chair. And the eye's either full of blood or partially full of blood. So there's kind of your two different quantities. That would be like a grade one on the bottom. It's like less than a third of the eye is full of blood. The bottom one, on the top, the bottom one would be a full, what we call eight ball hyphema. Just top to bottom blood, full. Like I said, your job, get them in the hands of the eye doctor so you can manage their pressure. And then we decide if they need to go to a surgeon to drain out the front of the eye. If that happens, we'll get them in the hands of the right surgeon for that, and then minimize their mobility and activity. If they have things like sickle cell anemia and stuff, a lot of times that's the one thing you'll see these with without trauma. They'll walk in and they'll have sickle cell, and they'll have a hyphema. Those are people, same protocol. Minimal movement, get them to see an eye doctor, and work on that. Okay. Now, we're through. This from here on should go really, really fast, because you guys are really ever going to have to deal with any of this stuff. A cataract. The technical definition for a cataract is any opacity or cloudiness of the lens inside the eye, so the lenticular lens. So you remember, we saw the picture, we have the iris, and right behind the iris, that lens. That lens helps us focus. Usually, in the fifth to sixth decade of life, that lens begins to get cloudy. It starts off becoming yellow, then it moves to a frosty white in color. Cataracts can actually happen at any point in the ball game, though. So I had a 32-year-old that came in the other day that had cataract surgery. He had a cataract in 5 years and finally got his vision. What makes a cataract clinically significant is it's affecting your vision. Okay, has very little to do with how the lens looks or anything like that. What we have to do is we have to prove to people's insurance company that the cloudiness of their lens is affecting their vision to a point that that they can't do what they need to do. And the insurance guy has pretty specific guidelines on how bad a cataract has to be before they'll pay for surgery. But the ultimate fix is surgery. I always tell people, everyone gets cataracts if you have enough birthdays. There are side effects of birthdays. And the fix for them is surgery. And until we do surgery, they're just annoying. So usually the glasses prescription changes and things like that. But it's a side effect of wear and tear. 30 people are predisposed to get cataracts at a younger age. People who are on high-dose steroids. So think about if you ever work in a rheumatology clinic and you have people with autoimmune diseases and they've been on oral steroids forever. Those people can get cataracts at a younger age, and then diabetics can get cataracts at a younger age as well, just because everything seems to happen faster in diabetics. Trauma, you can also get cataracts from that. And certain nutritional disorders cause a very particular type of cataract, but that's mainly in like third world countries, it's not here. And radiation, so glass, we call it glass blower's cataract. So people who are on a high amount of infrared light and radiation, those people usually, you see glass blowers and they have the big black goggles on, or welders have their masks on. That's part of what can cause cataracts at a younger age if they're exposed to those. So here's kind of a graph of some of the different types of cataracts. There's lots of different ones. The hypermature cataract, you see it looks like a lens that's about to explode because it's so old. That yellow dark lens like that is the that you see right next to it is a mature cataract. Immature cataracts are just a little bit of central clouding. The nuclear cataract is what most people get most often, the one on the bottom left hand. And the nuclear cataract is just a diffuse widening from the inside out. And then the one that people get at a younger age is that posterior subcapsular cataract, and you will never see that unless you have their eyes dilated and they're looking under a microscope and know how to focus on the back surface of the lens. It's hard to see. But it makes their vision go downhill in a period of a week or two. So that's cataracts. The solution is take out the cloud lens and put in a lens implant, like you see there, that IOL. It stands for intraocular lens. Okay? And the cool thing about cataract surgery is if you wear glasses, usually you don't need them anymore after cataract surgery. So they try to put your glasses prescription in. But that's what it looks like under a microscope. That would be a pretty significant nuclear sclerotic cataract. That would be what a posterior subcapsular cataract looked like. It's just like a rubbed glass. It looks like scratched glass on the back surface. And then that's a cortical cataract. So believe it or not, people can see 20/20 through those things sometimes. Kind of crazy. You would think you would be able to see through that, but they can do pretty good. Happens at any phase of life. Main treatment until we decide to do surgery is update their glasses prescription and make sure they're safe to drive. They're not going to hurt themselves or anybody else. So prescriptions can change on a monthly basis until it gets bad enough. So you guys want to take a break? You guys want to muscle through?
Muscle through.
Okay. We're blowing, I promise. So back of the eye now. Optic nerve. Glaucoma is not a single clinical entity. It's a group of ocular diseases. Glaucoma is, I tell people, when you say somebody has glaucoma, it's kind of like saying they have a back problem. Well, do they have a pinched nerve? Do they have a slip disc? Do they have a congenital scoliosis? What do they have? There's so many different types of back problems, right? Well, same thing with glaucoma. When I say somebody has glaucoma, it's a spectrum of diseases, but they all kind of, the overarching principle is the same. And it's a progressive optic neuropathy leading to visual loss of visual function. It's the second leading cause of blindness worldwide. It's the third most cause of blindness in the United States. Chronic and slow progressing, so it's very frustrating because it takes a while to diagnose definitively. And I like to call it the silent thief of vision. So I've been practicing for 7 years, and I've had 4 patients sit down in my chair that were in what we call end-stage glaucoma. 3 of those patients are blind now. None of them had a clue. So all of them are people who haven't had an eye exam in about 10 plus years. So the problem in a place like the United States, if you go blind from glaucoma, I don't want to say it's your fault, but it's our system's fault. Because people who give routine eye care and eye care professionals who pay attention don't have people that go blind from glaucoma. They have people that lose vision from glaucoma, but they don't have people that go blind. Okay? So your job is to make sure you're reminding people it's important to get an eye exam every once in a while, preferably every year, but at least every once in a while, even if they don't wear glasses, even if they're perfectly healthy, because things like this can fly under the radar, and you won't even see them with a direct ophthalmoscope in their eyes dilated. So glaucoma is a disease. It's a progressive optic neuropathy, progressive atrophy of the tissue in the retina and the back of the eye. Always gets the side vision first and works its way central. Okay? Starts out as weak spots in the peripheral vision, getting to bigger weak spots, and moves towards your central vision over the course of 20, 30 years. Okay? So big, big thing. Here's some of the glaucomas we deal with on a regular basis. And we're getting into the things that you guys won't ever deal with because these are the chronic eye care things that we deal with. They're not the foreign bodies and stuff you're fixing and moving on. These are the things you're dealing with for the rest of their lives. But glaucoma basically usually starts off with high pressure inside the eye or some type of insult to the tissue in the back of the eye. There's primary glaucomas. Like the most common thing we see is primary open-angle glaucoma, which means the pressure is high for some reason other than the drain being blocked. There's normal tension glaucoma, so people who don't have high pressure. There's ocular hypertension, so people who have high pressure in the eye that maybe they actually don't have glaucoma. Their pressure's just really high for whatever reason. And then there's a thing called congenital glaucoma, which if you ever work in pediatrics, you need to know about. We'll talk about that in a second, what you need to look for. Secondary glaucomas can be secondary to your anatomy, so you can actually have a setup to where you don't have much room in the front part of your eye, the fluid can't leave, and the pressure gets high or goes up and down throughout the day. Other systemic problems like pigment dispersion syndrome and things like that can clog up the drain. Getting whacked in the eye. One of the things anytime we see a hyphema, usually there's blunt force trauma, or we see a orbital blowout fracture. What we're watching for 6 months, a year after the road, is we're watching for recession of what we call the angle where the drain is in the eye, and glaucoma. We monitor that with pressure and a couple other techniques. You can have glaucoma that you get from a cataract getting too big and blocking the flow of fluid. You can have blood vessel growth if you're a diabetic that grows into the drain of your eye and clogs things up. If you're on long-term oral steroids, it can cause the pressure inside your eyes to go up, or topical steroids, it can cause things to happen. So there's just a lot of different reasons why it happens, but it always ends bad. So some of the risk factors we look at: age, race, genetics, corneal thickness, pressure, visual fields, anatomy, I put visual fields twice, look at that, and diabetes and metabolic syndrome as a whole. These are things that we're going to detect on a yearly eye exam, monitor, and treat. The problem is with glaucoma, we don't have a cure, so all we do is we have to diagnose it. And once we diagnose it, our job becomes the job of a plumber. And so what we do is we basically lower the pressure inside the eye. And we can do that with surgery, or we can do that with drops. Okay? And there's lots of different ways to do that. And usually we kind of tailor the treatment plan to the reason why the glaucoma is occurring. So if I tell you my job is a plumber, and then I tell my patients this analogy all the time, I say, okay, now you have glaucoma. We know, we've done all these tests, we've proven that you've lost vision, or that your pressure's too high, or that things are changing in the back of the eye. To use the plumber analogy, if you were to walk into your house and turn on the sink full blast, or just turn it on in a normal steady drip, you could leave, go on vacation for a week, come back, and if your sink's working like it's supposed to, the water's been draining, more water's been coming in, and everything's fine, right? It's just kind of a full sink sitting there. But if your drain isn't draining fast enough, or if the water's coming out way too fast, what happens is the sink overflows, right? Same thing inside the eye. The fluid kind of builds up inside the eye, causes the pressure to go up, and pressure basically starts to cause the tissue in the back of the eye to die. And so as the tissue in the back of the eye dies, vision starts to go. And usually we see that whenever we look at the back of the eye. So if you guys look up there, the optic nerve that you see on the left-hand side would be kind of what we would consider a normal, healthy optic nerve. And what you pay attention to is you pay attention to the center of it. So you see that light, kind of whitish-yellow area in the center? That's what we call the cup. And we measure kind of the cup-to-disc ratio. So the whole circle is the disc, and the little tiny white area in the middle is the cup that's a scooped-out divot. And you can see when you go to the other photo a drastically different picture, right? Well, what that is, that increased scooped-out cup in there, is basically where all the tissue has died and everything's thin. And so that is deep and wide. And so when we see that, we have to go, okay, is that glaucoma? And there's a lot of people that are just born that way. They have a nerve that looks like that. So you might look back there and somebody's nerve and go, whoa, your nerve does not look normal. Remember, like 60% of the population has a funny-looking nerve? When you look in there, well, you're going to send these people to us so we can do the work up with the visual field and all the other imaging classes. We have to see, okay, are things actually thin? Are they thinning as we watch them over time, and are they losing vision? And then if they are, we put them on some type of therapy to slow it down. So if I'm treating you for glaucoma and you're 30, it's different than if I'm treating you for glaucoma and you're 80 or 90. Because I have to go, what do I do to make sure you can see on your last day when you're a wrinkly old lady or guy in the nursing home? And if you're 30, I have a long time left. I have to do that. So I have to be a lot more aggressive. If you're 80, I mean, I have 90-year-olds that I'm sure have glaucoma, but they still have a lot of vision left, and they're not going to lose it in the next 10, 15 years. So I kind of give them the options. You want to use drops every day for the rest of your life, or you want to just kind of let's keep watching it? Because if I were to let's get out of hand, so it's kind of a catch-22 that we encounter a lot. But this is kind of a stage of glaucoma cupping you see here. So these are graphical representations starting at the top left. So basically that would be like a CD of 0.2 cup to disc ratio. Then you go over and you get like more 0.4, 0.5, getting like a 0.6, you know, 0.8, 0.9, and then end stage glaucoma. There's basically no rigid tissue left. This is kind of a graphical representation of how the fluid mechanics of the eye work. So you see there's those little finger processes behind the iris. Those produce the fluid. The fluid flows around where the arrows go and comes up in front of the iris and then goes over to where the cornea meets the iris, and what we call the angle. And remember, that's a circle, so it goes all the way around. And that's the drain of the eye. And the drain of the eye is called the trabecular meshwork, and that can be the problem. It can be that that's getting clogged up with pigment or lots of other things, but that's the underlying process of glaucoma. One of the things, we monitor structure and function, so we want to see what the tissue looks like, but we also want to see what their vision is. So we use